This is Chicken Philosophy, Martin Luther, part 21. And I know what some of you are thinking. You're thinking, Gwydion, I'm pretty sure Madonna was raised Catholic, not Protestant. And that song came out as an advertisement for Pepsi, not Coca-Cola. And these are all valid points. I, too, have a valid point to make. And that is that this is the halfway point of the color wheel series of 15 videos. See, these videos, though there's hundreds, generally these days, there's a cycle of 15 based on the colors, based on the book combined with the persona. I'm Gwydion, represented as red. Oh, let's do this. Yeah, that's very nice. Martin Luther is orange for some reason. And so, so we're in the middle, 8 out of 15. Enough about that. Should we get to the reading? I'm trying to be very excited because we finished last time. Somebody finished, whoever that was, BT, I think, finished the... Martin Luther's introduction to Paul's epistle to the Romans. And so now we're going to read something else. It's unknown. And unknown means it might be good. Oh, you know what I forgot to do?
I almost forgot
three things. One, the incense. So this, today, we're going with Manjushri incense. I'm in a little bit of a goofy mood, you might have noticed, because... I'm excited. I wasn't going to record this today because given the choice between doing another episode of Buddhist Books Podcast, as dull as the Mahavagga of the Vinaya Pitaka may be, it beat the hell out of reading Martin Luther, I mean, I'll tell you. But then I thought about the fact that we finished Teilhard de Chardin. We read the very last Teilhard de Chardin word on this program. And with that, we closed the Catholicism chapter. And the next time the purple comes back, we will be opening the Gnosticism chapter, which is very exciting. So, yeah, now we're in kind of a no space in between. And, yeah, so that's exciting to me. And it was enough to motivate me. That plus I had a few silly ideas about what to do for the opening today. Where I was going to play that song, Madonna, Like a Prayer. You just saw all the silly ideas. So there's no need for me to rehash that, is there? All right, so Manjushri. You can recognize Manjushri because he carries a sword. I think he's probably, at least among the like Tibetan, Buddhist deities or bodhisattvas, he's the only one that carries a sword. There's probably some Japanese ones that carry various weapons. But anyway, Dharma protectors mostly. But Manjushri, a story I know is he cut the Kathmandu River Valley with his sword, apparently. So there you go. It smells very nice. It smells like a Tibetan temple. All right, so the incense is done. Now for the beverage. Is it going to be coffee, tea, wine, water, nothing? Milk. Oh, a trigger warning for any vegans out there. Sorry. Okay. Now, the only thing that's left is for me to go get the magnifying glass. And no doubt Editor Edward will have trimmed that down a bit. So, now we can get started. Let's do it, shall we? What do we got? Confession concerning Christ's Supper. Part three? Part three? Are the first two parts missing? Maybe they'll explain. All right. 1528, good year. Not really. Okay. In 1527, pressure on Luther mounts. He's physically ill. Katie's late-term pregnancy turns problematic, and their baby will die soon after birth. That's very sad, and also, what? Martin Luther has a wife and a baby on the way? Didn't he take monastic vows? Then again, he is always telling people, hey, don't worry about your monastic vows, unless you want to. So, well, we see where what camp he fell into. All right, bubonic plague hits Wittenberg, and the university moves classes to Jena, parentheses about 100 miles away, end parentheses for safety. But Luther remains and assumes pastoral duties during the epidemic. Makes him a little more relatable. We too had an epidemic recently. Not quite bubonic plague level, but... Anyway, his reform proposal and its disposition have emboldened disseparate protest movements across Europe, but attempts to unify them are failing. He's racked with self-doubt. In November, he gathers himself to write a three-part, quote, confession, end quote. In this concluding section, published in February 1528, Luther affirms classic creedal teachings on the Trinity and the person of Jesus Christ. He confesses a distinctively Lutheran view. What a coincidence. His name is Luther and he's got a Lutheran view. Huh, wonder if anybody ever put that together before. I'm joking, of course. All right. Anyway, sorry. Enough levity. He confesses a distinctly Lutheran view of the sacraments and the church. He connects the vocations of all believers to serve their neighbors with the divinely established, quote, orders of creation, quote. So, if I had to guess, they don't seem to be saying it, but this is part three. I think part one and part two have been lost to the sands of time. Like one of those Tibetan mandalas that they intentionally lose to the sands of time, unless there's some idiot there filming it. Then they can be like, oh, look, isn't it pretty? No, the point is that it goes away and you never see it again. The wind takes it away. Everybody remembers seeing it, but it's gone now. Unless you film it or take a picture. Dummy. Okay, now this is Martin Luther talking. I'll do the voice. As I see it, the fractures in the church's unity, along with the errors that go with them, continue to multiply as time goes on. And I can see that Satan's wrath, trigger warning for me saying Satan at random points during the episode, happens. His wrath and revenge have no end. I, therefore, want to confess my faith before God and all the world, point by point. That way, no one during my lifetime or after my death should be able to misuse me or my writings in support of their false ideas. As the, quote, communion baptism fanatics, end quote, are already doing. I commit myself to remain in this faith until I die. And with God's help, I will trust this faith as I leave this world and present myself before our Lord Jesus Christ's seat of judgment. That way, if a person claims, once I've died, that Luther would teach and maintain such and such a thing differently if he were still living because he did not think through, then allow me to say finally, by the grace of God, I have carefully considered each of these doctrines. I have looked at their biblical bases carefully, and I am now prepared to preserve them once and for all. just as I have safeguarded the sacraments of the altar. I am not drunk or unaware of what this means. I have considered the issues carefully, and I know what I'm talking about. I have a clear sense of what might be at stake here for me when the Lord Jesus Christ returns in final judgment. This is no joke, and it is nothing to be taken lightly. This is indeed serious stuff. Because of God's grace, I have come to recognize Satan when I see him. If
the devil
can twist and pervert God's word and the Bible, then how much more could the
evil one
do to the words of others as well as to mine? First, I believe from my heart in the supreme article of the majesty of God, that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, three distinct persons, are by nature one true and genuine God, the maker of heaven, earth, and all things, in opposition to the Arians, Macedonians, Sabellians, and similar heretics. Genesis 1:1, this is how it has been held until now, in the Church of Rome and in other Christian churches throughout the whole world. Did he just acknowledge the existence of Eastern Orthodoxy? Second, I believe in and I hold to this scriptural truth, only the second person of the Godhead, that is, the Son, became a true human being. The Holy Spirit conceived him apart from any cooperation of a male. And the pure, holy Virgin Mary brought him into the world as a natural mother. Saint Luke clearly speaks of this, and the prophets proclaim that neither the Father nor the Holy Spirit became human, and certain heretics have taught. You know who didn't speak of that? Matthew, Mark, and John. I'm pretty sure they didn't talk about that. Also, we're going to be reading Nag Hammadi, so we'll see if any of the other 600 Gospels that weren't included in the Bible mention anything about Luke's little fantasy, little pagan fantasy based on astrology and, you know, stuff. The nativity scene. Don't you love Christmas? Anyway, also, I believe that God the Son did not take on only a body without a soul, as some heretics have taught, but rather his humanity was full and complete, soul and all. As a true descendant of Abraham and David, as promised, he was the natural-born son of Mary. The Son was a complete and true human being in every
You are fully functional, aren't you?
Of course, but...
He was like every other person, as I am myself, ... Outside of the fact that he came without sin, from the Virgin by means of the Holy Spirit. Also, I believe that this particular person is true God, one, eternal, indivisible being from God who became human. Therefore, the Holy Virgin Mary is unquestionably a true mother, not only of the human Christ, as the Nestorians teach, but she is also mother of the Son of God. As Luke 1:35 says, quote, "The Holy Child shall be called the Son of God," end quote. In other words, he is my Lord and the Lord of all creation. Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, by nature of both God and Mary, true God and true human. I believe also that this Son of God and Son of Mary, our Lord Jesus Christ, suffered for us poor sinners, was crucified, dead, and buried, in order that he might redeem us from sin, death, and the eternal wrath of God by his innocent blood. See, what they used to do was, people would be like sinful, right? So they'd take an innocent lamb and kill the lamb and say, all right, now we're not sinful. That makes sense, right? Right? Yeah, that makes sense. Right? Right? So Jesus did it for the lambs. He was kind of an animal rights guy. Now they don't sacrifice lambs anymore. Okay, that's one way to look at it. Right. I also believe that on the third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Christ is Lord over all lords and King over all kings. Christ is above creation, in heaven and on earth, and under the earth, above death and life, and above sin and righteousness. This I confess, and this I can prove from the Bible. Every human being is a descendant from a single person, Adam. And everyone by birth has received and inherited the fall, guilt, and sin of this particular individual. Martin Luther, down with the ecumenical councils, down with original sin. Adam started it in the garden, parentheses, even though the evil deceit of the devil brought it on, end parentheses. Therefore, we all enter the world, we live, and we die in sin. We are just like Adam. If Jesus Christ had not come to our aid, taking to himself our guilt and sin, and suffering like an innocent lamb, you remember that thing that totally made sense? Right? Sorry. A ransom for us, then we would deserve death. And even more, Christ continues to intercede and advocate for us as the faithful, merciful mediator, Savior. Indeed, Christ is the only priest and bishop of our souls. Along with this, then, I do not accept and must condemn as unqualified errors, any doctrines that overly stress the role of our free will. They are completely contrary to the assistance and grace of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Without Christ, death and sin enslave us, and the devil is our Lord and God. We have neither the ability nor the power, neither the intellect nor the capacity to prepare ourselves to receive life and righteousness, or to pursue it. Indeed, the reverse is true. Our weakness and captivity to sin continue. The devil owns us. So we do and think whatever he wishes and whatever contradicts the commandments of God. Do I need to say anything? All right. I think the tone of voice hopefully is enough to convey. In addition, I condemn the Pelagians, old and new. I don't care enough to ask Editor Edward to explain who that is. They will not acknowledge that original sin is sin. Okay. Rather, they conceive of it as a sort of illness or defect. I condemn them, because death confronts us all. You know what they say? Condemn not, lest ye be condemned. Oh, fuck. Martin Luther, I think you fucked up. Somewhere in there. Never mind. I condemn them because death confronts us all. And that means original sin must be more than simply some sort of sickness. Indeed, it is a massive sin. As St. Paul says, quote, the wages of sin is death. End quote. Quote, the sting of death is sin. End quote. David puts it in this way in Psalm 51. Quote, can I please have Bathsheba? She's so hot, Lord. Oh, wait, no, this was when he was a bit younger. Sorry. Psalm 51. Quote, indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner, when my mother conceived me. End quote. He does not say, quote, my mother conceived me with sin, end quote, but, quote, I was a sinner when my mother conceived me, end quote, and, quote, I was born guilty, end quote. The Hebrew text, put another way, says that I have grown from sinful seed. Furthermore, I do not accept and must condemn all monastic orders, rules, cloisters, and religious foundations as absolute lies. They are mere devilish errors concocted by humans and instituted apart from and above Scripture. With these errors, they would hold the word captive, capital W word, obviously, by their vows and obligations. In spite of the numerous celebrated saints who have lived monastic lives as God's elect, monasticism led them astray. But now, because faith in Jesus Christ redeemed them, they have gotten out. Because monastic rules, foundations, and cults continued to grow with the notion that their disciplines and acts contribute to and obtain salvation, parentheses, and thereby escape sin and death, end parentheses. They are shameful, disgusting blasphemies. I raise a toast to you and I and all shameful, disgusting blasphemers. May you have a wonderful day. Okay. Right. Where were we? I don't know. They reject the irreplaceable help and grace of Jesus Christ, our only Savior and Mediator, because, quote, there is no other name given by which we must be saved, end quote, than Jesus Christ. There cannot be other saviors, parentheses, or other paths, end parentheses, to salvation, then through our Savior Jesus Christ and the specific kind of righteousness he gives to us. Okay, Metatron. I'm not talking about the Archangel, I'm talking about the YouTuber. He still says shit like this in 2024. I mean, you can forgive someone in 1527 or 28, but... Anyway, sorry. Where was I? Yes. And the specific kind of righteousness he gives to us, the righteous Christ, our one, quote, mercy seat, end quote, offers to God for us. It would be acceptable if monasteries and religious foundations were kept for the purpose of teaching young people the Word of God, the Scriptures, and Christian ethics. That way, we could educate and train upstanding, skilled men to serve as bishops, pastors, and other workers in the church. We could not only nurture competent, learned men for civil government, we could also raise good, respectable, educated women who can keep house and train children in a Christian manner. Again, 1528. Some people still say that in 2024. My God. I mean, it's kind of nice in a way. I mean, in a very abstract way. Like, if you're looking at the world as a zoo, it's nice that you can see, like, if you go to North Sentinel Island and Andaman Islands, Well, don't go there, first of all. It's illegal and you'll get killed. But if you look at it through binoculars, you can see like middle Stone Age people living. And if, wherever you look in the world, you can find people who still haven't been introduced to, you know, the modern world on various levels. And then people who cling to, you know, the Amish are still living in, what is it, 1630 specifically? Like, there's only, like, that level of technology, nothing newer, but everything, never mind. You find a lot of different kinds of people, is what I'm saying. They all live in present time. And it's a little rude sometimes when people talk about people as if they live in the past. I mean, they, in a certain way, people do live in the past. That's kind of the point I'm making. Then there's the people that live in the present, and the people that live in the future, a few people. I think that, you know, the people with means are able to, like, oh, look at this. Like, the first people who had iPhones, and they're like, oh, look at this. You touch it, you can drag it along. And everybody was like, oh, my God, you're a fucking magician. You know, what was that, 2008, 2009? Sorry. I'll just... Well, yeah. Right. If it would be acceptable, no, we read that already. We could not only, yes, but also women. As ways of seeking salvation, however, these institutions are the devil's dogma and creed. But the holy orders and true religious institutions established by God are these three. The office of priest. The estate of marriage. The civil government. All right. All who are engaged in the clerical office or ministry of the word are in a holy, proper, good, and God-pleasing order and estate, such as those who preach, administer sacraments, supervise the common chest. What? Yes. Sextons and messengers or servants who serve such persons, these are engaged in works that are altogether holy in God's sight. Again, all fathers and mothers who regulate their household wisely and bring up their children to the service of God are engaged in pure holiness. In a holy work, and a holy order. Similarly, when children and servants show obedience to their elders and masters, again, 1528, 300 years before they outlawed that sort of thing, here too is pure holiness. And whoever is thus engaged is a living saint on earth. Now you see where Joseph Smith got the very loose definition of saint a few hundred years later. What is more, princes and lords, judges, civil officers, state officials, notaries, male and female servants, and all who serve such persons, and all their obedient subjects, all are engaged in true holiness and the pursuit of a holy life before God. These three religious institutions or orders are found in God's word and commandment. And whatever is contained in God's word must be holy, because God's word is holy and makes everything holy that is connected with it and involved in it. Sorry, Canaan. You guys just weren't holy enough. Higher than these three institutions and orders is the secular order of Christian love, in which one serves not only the three orders, but also every needy person in general with all kinds of benevolent deeds, feeding the hungry. All right, I can't really fault Martin Luther when he talks about shit like this. Providing drink to the thirsty. Forgiving one's enemies. Praying for all people on earth. Enduring all kinds of evil on earth, etc. You see, each of these are good and holy acts. None of these orders, however, is a means of salvation. There remains only one way above them all. Faith in Jesus Christ. So we distinguish between, quote, being saved, end quote, and, quote, being holy, end quote. We are saved through Christ alone, but we become holy both through his faith and through these divine foundations and orders. The godless may have much about them that is holy, but that does not save them, because God desires that we do such works to the praise and glory of the Almighty. And everyone whom Christ saves through faith certainly does these works and maintains these orders. What we said about the estate of marriage, however, applies also to widows and unmarried women, because they too belong to the domestic sphere. Again, trigger warning for anyone living after 1528. Now, if these orders and divine institutions do not save, what can we say about the effects of the devil's institutions and monasteries that have arisen apart from the word of God, and now they rage and fight against the one and only way of faith. Third, I believe in the Holy Spirit, who with the Father and the Son is one true God and proceeds eternally from the Father and the Son. I'm still using this stupid mistranslation. In the original Nicene Creed, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and is worshipped together with the Father and the Son. And then 700 years after the Nicene Creed was written, they started saying, proceeds from the Father and the Son. And then the church split in half over that and other issues. But the Roman half was the one with the new revision, where it's like, oh, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. So, in a sense, Jesus is his own dad. Ew. Did you ever read Rant by Chuck Palahniuk, the author of Fight Club? He's his own dad, grandfather, great-grandfather, and... It's a little gross. It involves time travel. Obviously, that's the only way to be your own. Okay, where were we? What? I don't know. I guess that's the end of the episode, is when I lose track of where I was. I'm going to put the little sticker up on top, hopefully. Whoever's up next will remember. Edward, I think, will be next for the Martin Luther, part 22. We'll remember to check the end of this and see where we left off so that he can jump in right there, right where we left off. Special thanks to the Carrot and to the Deadpool and Wolverine Coca-Cola cans for, you know, representing orange and red for this episode. Next time, it'll be yellow and white. In other words, it'll be BT reading The Secret of the Golden Flower.